Good to be back. I need to remember how to do this. Seems like it's been a while. It's very good to be back. Thank you for your prayers. We, Jan and I both did very well with the COVID-19. She didn't get it, even though she was quarantined with me for the time that I had to be quarantined. She never got a symptom at all. And my symptoms were very mild. I had a fever for a couple days, had the chills for a day, and that was it. Never lost my sense of taste or smell, never had headaches or any of the other things that are part of this horrible virus. And here I stand. So thank you for prayers. When we left Paul, kind of stranded in the middle of the Mediterranean on his way to Rome, but the ship was in great jeopardy. They're tossing stuff over and about to toss people over. So we're going to get him out of the ocean today. Acts 27, verse 39 is where we begin, and we'll go down through chapter 28, verse 10. When day came, they could not recognize the land, but they did observe a bay with a beach, and they resolved to drive the ship onto it if they could. And casting off the anchors, they left them in the sea, while at the same time they were loosening the ropes of the rudders and hoisting the foresail to the wind. They were headed for the beach, but striking a reef where two seas met, they ran the vessel aground, and the prow stuck fast and remained immovable, but the stern began to be broken up by the force of the waves. The soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners so that none of them would swim away and escape. But the centurion, wanting to bring Paul safely through, kept them from their intention and commanded that those who could swim should jump overboard first and get to land, and the rest should follow, some on planks and others on various things from the ship. And so it happened that they all were brought safely to land. When they had been brought safely through, then we found out that the island was called Malta. The natives showed us extraordinary kindness, for because of the rain that had set in and because of the cold, they kindled a fire and received us all. But when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, a viper came out because of the heat and fastened itself on his hand. When the natives saw the creature hanging from his hand, they began saying to one another, "Undoubtedly this man is a murderer, and though he has been saved from the sea, justice has not allowed him to live." However, he shook the creature off into the fire and suffered no harm. But they were expecting that he was about to swell up or suddenly fall down dead. But after they'd waited a long time and had seen nothing unusual happen to him, they changed their minds and began to say that he was a god. Now in the neighborhood of that place were lands belonging to the leading man of the island named Publius, who welcomed us and entertained us courteously 3 days. And it happened that the father of Publius was lying in bed, afflicted with recurrent fever and dysentery. And Paul went in to see him, and after he had prayed, he laid his hands on him and healed him. After this had happened, the rest of the people on the island who had diseases were coming to him and getting cured. He also honored us with many marks of respect. And when we were setting sail, they supplied us with all we needed. What an interesting turn of events. So we're in the story of this journey toward Rome. We're almost there. Nick, if you can get the map up, we'll show you kind of where we are. See the little island right there? That's Malta. See that boot right there? Everybody knows what that is, right? Everybody knows. And there's Rome. So they're not far. They just didn't make it. Not yet. And because the seas are rough and because of the storm and everything else that's going on, they try. They see a beach and they aim for the beach and they do everything they can with the ship to get to the beach. But on the way to the beach, there's a reef. And the ship hits the reef and it stops dead in the water. And the prow is stopped up against the reef, and the stern The rear of the ship is getting battered by the waves and it's coming apart. So the soldiers who are on board decide, they've got prisoners other than Paul, they decide, well, we need to kill the prisoners so they don't escape. Because if they escape, it's on us, and we have to give account for that. But the centurion that's there has taken a liking to Paul. We've seen that prior to this. And so he tells them, leave him alone. Don't do that. You don't have to kill him. If you can swim, swim. Swim to shore and get to this island. And if you can't, there's enough debris in the water right now. Grab some of the driftwood from the boat, the pieces of the stern that are floating out there, or whatever else will help you float, and get to shore. And do you notice what it says here? They were all brought safely to land. In chapter 27, verse 21, Paul, because of the weather, a lot of them are not eating. They're throwing stuff overboard. Probably throwing chum overboard too. If you've been seasick, you know what I'm talking about. So Paul, who is not a sailor, but knows a little bit of something about traveling on the sea, chastises him a bit in verse 21 of chapter 27. Says, men, you ought to have followed my advice and not to have set sail from Crete. A little late, Paul. Good advice, but a little late. And we wouldn't have incurred this damage and loss. Now I urge you to keep your courage. Why does he urge them to keep their courage? There will be no loss of life among you. How does he know this? He's not a sailor. He's not a pilot. He's not in charge. But he knows who's in charge, doesn't he? We're going to lose the ship, but there's going to be no loss of life. For this very night, an angel of the God whom, to whom I belong and whom I serve stood before me, saying, do not be afraid, Paul. You must stand before Caesar, and behold, God has granted you all those who are sailing with you. Paul says, I have it on very good authority. We're all going to make it. That's got to be encouraging. In the middle of a storm, that's got to be encouraging to know you're going to make it. You're going to make it. It's like getting a diagnosis about an illness and the doctor saying, you're going to make it. You're going to get through this and you're going to make it. So Paul knows, because he knows God and he knows that God has spoken to him. And where's he headed? Where is he? Almost Malta. He's in the middle of the ocean right here, but he knows from God, I'm going to make it to Rome. And you all are going to make it. So he says, therefore, keep up your courage, men, because I believe God that it will turn out exactly as I have been told. We will run aground on a certain island, and the island is Malta. When they get there, wet and cold and everything else, the natives of Malta greet them, and they've started a bonfire for them. They've watched this happening on the reef. They've watched the ship break up. They've watched these folks swim to shore or float to shore on the debris. So they've seen it all happening. So they start a fire for them. Excuse me. And when they get there, the fire is going. So Paul goes and he gathers some more wood for the fire. But what a gracious thing to do. These folks don't know any of these people. They just know that they're in trouble. And they greet them literally warmly with a fire. And so Paul goes and gets some more wood for the fire. And as he's dropping the wood on the fire, the heat drives a viper, a snake, out of the wood, and it attaches to Paul's hand. When that happens, you're going to die. poisonous snake. And so the people of the island see this happen. And Paul just shakes it off into the fire. And they're watching to see what will happen. They figured, the superstition that prevailed there was he must have been a bad person. Must have been a murderer. He must have done something to deserve punishment because he escaped the waves, but he didn't escape the viper. So justice has not allowed him to live, they say. So they're watching, and they're waiting, and nothing, nothing. Paul's fine. And they watch him, and they change their opinion, they change their minds. Wow, he didn't die. This viper, this snake didn't have any effect on him. He didn't die. He's fine. He must be a god. Not a superstition in those days. And so if he didn't die, he must be a god who has power over things like serpents because he didn't die. Their original response is saying, undoubtedly this man's a murderer, and though he's been saved from the sea, justice has not allowed him to live. He's going to die. But he doesn't. Why? Where's he going? Yeah, he's not in Rome yet, is he? He's in Malta. So a snake is not going to stop him from getting to where God wants him to go. And now they're received by the leading man of Malta, Publius is his name, who owns a lot of property. It was something like a mayor or something on the island. And for 3 days he entertained them and took care of them and fed them, all of that. Now Luke is there. That's why we're getting all these details. Because Luke is with Paul in this journey. So he gives us the details of the serpent and the fact that Paul doesn't die because the serpent bites him. And then we get the details about Publius's father. He's sick. He's got a fever and he's got dysentery. Luke's a physician. We need to know that. We really don't need to know that, do we? But and from Luke's point of view, fever and dysentery were deadly in those days. Could easily die from fever and dysentery. Body dehydrates and you die. So Paul goes in to see him. He goes in to see Publius's father. And he prays for him. And he lays hands on him. And he's healed. Well, word gets out. Malta is very small. I showed you, but the map's not up there, but it's a very small place off of the boot of Italy. So people on the island start coming to Paul. So all of a sudden he has unexpected and unanticipated ministry to the people of Malta. And knowing Paul, he shares the gospel as he's healing these people who are coming to him. He's sharing where the power comes from. It doesn't come from Paul. He's denied elsewhere in the book of Acts that he's a god. He doesn't claim any deity whatsoever, but he does claim to know the one who heals. And so these people are being healed as they come to see Paul. And then it says they're honored. These people are honored. But these people honor the people who just survived the shipwreck. Now, by all rights, they should have died in the sea. They shouldn't have made it. If they didn't die in the sea, they should have been thrown overboard and killed by the soldiers on the boat. But every single one of them, including the prisoners, including Paul, including Luke, including all of those people, every one of them makes it, because God made a promise that they would. And God keeps his promises, takes care of them all the way through. And not only that, but they're honored by the people of Malta. They provide for them when it comes time, 3 months later, when it comes time for them to set sail, when the weather is better. If they'd hung out in Crete for those 3 months, they would have had a much easier passage. But because they didn't, all of these things happened. But even though these things happened, God superintended the whole thing, and they all got through whole and alive. So 3 months later, when they're ready to go, the folks from Malta, it says in verse 10, supplied us with all that we needed. But notice that what the angel promised, God fulfilled. All of these people made it through. And all of these people got on another boat, an Alexandrian ship, and they got back on the road, or on the sea, to Rome. Paul had to testify in Rome. Just as he had testified in Jerusalem, he has to testify in Rome. Now, why Rome? We've been talking about the fact that he's on his way to Rome for a while now, with interruptions for the holidays. Rome is the seat of everything. Rome's the seat of power. Rome's the seat of government. Rome's the seat of religion. Rome is the seat of all authority, human authority, in the known world. What better place to share the gospel? What more important place to share the gospel than Rome? The gospel needs to get to Rome. The people in Rome need to hear the gospel. And so Paul is on his way to Rome, and he'll spend some time there. He'll write letters from there. He'll do all of that, and we'll get into that. God willing, we'll finish the book of Acts next week. Now that we've got Paul out of the ocean and on dry land, we can get him back on the ship, on another ship, and get him to Rome and talk about what happens when he gets there. But I want you to see that God is a God who keeps his promises all the way through. In Acts 21, like I said, Acts 23. That's what happens when you don't write things down. You think you remember it. My forgetter works a whole lot better than my rememberer these days. But in Acts 23, verse 11, it says, "But on the night immediately following, the Lord stood at his side," that is Paul's side. This is while he's before the council. And he says, "Take courage, for as you have solemnly witnessed to my cause at Jerusalem, so you must witness at Rome also." So the whole time that Paul is going through all of this, everything that's happening to him, what does he know? In the forefront of his mind, he's got a mission. God has called him to that mission, and God is going to get him there. God never says, anywhere you see God reminding Paul that he's going to Rome, he never says it's going to be an easy trip. He never says to Paul that it's going to be easy to follow him, to serve him, ever. He never says that it's going to be easy. It's like the old gospel chorus, "It's not an easy road, we're traveling to heaven. Many are the thorns on the way." God just promises his presence, and God promises that he will fulfill his mission. You will be my witness. Through beatings, through shipwrecks, through snake bite, through all of that, you will be my witness. I will get you where I want you. And he does. We read Isaiah 43 earlier as our call to worship. And it's just a reminder that God is the one who is with us through everything. "But now thus says the Lord, your creator, O Jacob, the The Lord, who is your creator, knows everything about us, knows everything, every molecule in our bodies. And he who formed you, O Israel, we are fearfully and wonderfully made, according to the psalmist, by the one who is our creator. It says, do not fear. Just that is enough for us to keep in our minds. Do not fear. No matter what comes, do not fear. It's easy to get fearful, isn't it? So easy to get fearful. This pandemic can make us fearful. What's going on in our capital can make us fearful. What's going on in the news can make us fearful. Planes that fall from the sky after 4 minutes in the air can make us fearful. Other diseases, there's other diseases going on around us, you know that. The folks that I mentioned this morning who had passed away, not one of them died of COVID-19, but they all died, and we all will. I did a funeral on Friday, and I reminded the folks there that every single one of us will die. Every single one of us is destined to die physically here. But that's not the end of things because of the God who made us. Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. What does that mean? I've bought you back. I've brought you back from the precipice to life. I've called you by name. You are mine. You realize the God of the universe, your creator, calls you by name? I wonder what name he uses for us. My name growing up was Ricky, except when my mom was mad. Then it was Richard Thomas. We all have different names, don't we? But God has a name for us that's a special name, and he calls us by that name. He knows our names. And then he says, you're mine. You're mine. If we are his, are we in good hands? Does he know how to take care of his own? Over and over in scripture, especially through the Psalms, he tells us, I know how to take care of you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. When you pass through the waters, I'll be with you. Doesn't say you won't pass through the waters, does it? But it does say, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. I've been in situations 3 times in my life where I almost drowned. Came really close. Last time I was in high school, and I was all full of vim and vinegar, and there were some really good waves off of Plum Island up in Massachusetts. Nobody was in the water. That should have been my first clue. But I'm 17 years old, and I'm thinking, I got this. I didn't think I was going to make it back in, but here I am. I honestly thought, well, this is it, and there's that. People say, and I don't know how you know this, because when people drown, you can't talk to them. But they say when you're drowning, it's a very calm way to go. And I felt a calmness come over me when I just resigned myself to the water. And when I did that, the water pushed me forward just enough so I could dig my hands into the sand and get out of there. That was the third time. That was the most memorable time. But I'm here. Went through triple bypass 2 years ago. I'm here. Talk about going through deep waters. I'm here. And we all can tell the same kinds of stories about what we've gone through, where God has been with us and got us through and will. And through the rivers, they will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be scorched, nor will the flame burn you. Why? Not because of who we are. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. Beloved, that's great news. What shall we say? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how shall he not with him give us all things? Our God is a God who is with us, just as he was with Paul and his companions on the ocean, and on the shore. I mean, he got through the shipwreck, and you think that'd be enough. Catch your breath, Paul. Get ready for the next wave. But then he gets bit by a snake. And you would think, Lord, isn't that enough? But he goes through more, but God is with him all the way. All the way, God is with him. And with us as well. God is with us. Whatever we go through, he is the God who is with us. The greatest part of the promise to Abraham wasn't offspring, wasn't property, wasn't territory. It was this: I will be with you and I will be your God and you shall be my people. That's the greatest promise. And through Jesus Christ, that's true. That we are his and his alone. And he will walk with us through everything we go through, no matter what it is. So take heart. Be encouraged. We're in a new year. Don't know what's around the corner. Everybody's so happy to get out of 2020. We'll see. I mean, we don't know. And I'm an optimist. I'm saying that as an optimist. We don't know. We honestly don't. This virus is not over. All right, we live in a powder keg world. We just don't know. But we do know this. God is for us. Who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son gave him up for us all. How shall he not with him give us all things? Not give us stuff, but just give us what we need in any circumstance. So as we enter this new world, take that with you. God is on your side. The God who will walk with you through whatever you face this year is the God who is with you. He is Emmanuel. Let's pray. God, we thank you that we can rely on you, count on you, depend on you in all circumstances. You don't promise an easy road. You don't promise to make it easy, but you do promise to be with us, and we thank you for that. Help us, Lord, to remember that in the tough times. It's easy when things are quiet. It's harder when things are tough. So help us to remember when things are tough that you are the God who is with us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that you promise to walk with us. You gave us your Holy Spirit, your Comforter, to walk alongside us. Help us to be encouraged no matter what comes. We thank you that we can be because of you. Amen.